two awesome fighters.
Train to fight?
I was training. I quit very shortly thereafter.
I like it. Time for us to go viral. It's the most wonderful time of the year. Oh. Check this out from yesterday. Santa Claus showing off his dance moves down in D.C.
Oh, get it, Santa? Oh, I like it. Get it, Santa. That's the best. They should see if he can play quarterback in Washington.
That's good stuff.
Yeah.
D.C. is not impressed.
Man, I like D.C., man. I used to love playing. I was just daydreaming about going down to play the Washington Redskins. Those were some good days.
There was a glaze. Yeah, there was a glaze.
Some good days. Were those Eagle days?
Yeah, good days. Good days. Good days. On and off the field. Good days
for
in D.C.
Stories to start your morning. Sponsored by Gillette Clear Gel.
We was dancing in the streets now.
Amari Cooper had an amazing game for the Cowboys. 10 catches, 217 yards, and 3 touchdowns, including the game winner. CC, how impressive has Amari been for the Cowboys?
Oh, amazing. Amazing. Man, Dak Prescott, is he happy. Santa Claus delivered him a gift early, thanks to the Raiders. Now they have an elite wide receiver. They have the best wide receiver, route runner, that's been in the Cowboys since Mike Orr. Didn't Jerry Jones say that?
Mm-hmm.
Man, sometimes when Jerry talks, we need to be listening.
The Dak splits pre-Amari and post-Amari are as jarring as the Cowboys splits record-wise. Cowboys were 2-5 before Amari got there. They're 3-4, pardon me. They're 5-1 with him. Dak's quarterback rating before Amari, 85 on the year. Since Amari, 122 on the year. I mean, he has been the turning point of their season.
Sticking with this game, the Eagles fell to 6-7 with a loss. Philly is now all but eliminated from playoff contention. See, what went so wrong for the Eagles?
A number of injuries, but the inability to understand how hard the NFL is year in and year out. They were last year, offseason, Doug Peterson writing a book. Now tell me, Doug, what have you ever done that deserves for you to write a book? So I thought right from the beginning, and this whole offseason, just talking about New England, oh, it's better here. We have more fun here. Well, how much fun are you going to have when you don't make the playoffs, huh? I believe they'll have a better offseason this year, and they will bounce back next year. Why? Because I believe in the quarterback, and I believe in Howie Roseman, and the types of players that they're going to bring into Philadelphia.
But this game was, to me, a microcosm of their entire season. Had a ton of opportunities, yes, and couldn't take advantage of them. Had moments where it looked like, oh, this is going to be the turning point of the game, of the season, and couldn't take advantage of it. And then don't get the overtime coin toss, and Dallas runs it down your throat. 8.5-minute drive to start.
If you're a quarterback anywhere in the world right now, send Philadelphia an application, a picture, and your bio.
The Saints clinched the NFC South with a win over the Bucs yesterday. New Orleans struggled throughout the first half, but scored 25 unanswered to improve to 11-2. Nick, what does this game tell you about the Saints?
The Saints last few weeks now struggling a little bit. If you didn't watch this game, you might say, oh, they won by 14. Tampa was in firm control of this game. They were up 14-3, force a strip sack on Breeze. Then the Saints don't score the next possession either. Really quality comeback against a Tampa team that looks like they're booking their offseason reservations. But the Saints got to click back into gear, especially with the window opening with the Rams' loss.
Yeah, you got to be careful playing against Tampa Bay. Right here, the Saints, a divisional opponent. They typically play them very, very tough. Only team to defeat them the first game of the season. Tampa Bay's got a good offense. So, listen, this NFL, it's rough. Man, the month of late November, December, it's rough. Sometimes it's not about drawing pretty pictures. It's about calculating wins. And that's the way they were able to do enough just to be able to get it done.
Finally, the Browns beat the Panthers 26-20. Baker Mayfield had 238 yards and a touchdown to lead Cleveland to their fifth win of the year. Carolina has now lost 5 straight. CC, you called this game for Fox. What was your biggest takeaway?
Man, at the end, Cam Newton, if he can make one throw, if he can put a little air on the football, his fundamentals, sometime under duress, sometime they leave him. I think he's too good of a passer in those goal line situations not to be able to come up with one of those throws. Late in the game, his best wide receiver, DJ Moore, he was injured. That's the reason why Curtis Samuel, they're throwing to him. And Curtis Samuel is a running back from Ohio State. He's developing as a wide receiver, but he can't be your go-to guy in the red zone, especially at the goal line, because he's not a jump ball guy. He's a speed guy, all right? That's the way. He's a reverse guy. He has not developed that part to his game yet. So Cam was not very, very sharp at the end, but Baker Mayfield and the type of energy, not only that he's put into this team, you could feel it in the city. Now, it was cold. in Cleveland. In the morning, the streets, the vendors out, the atmosphere, the fans talking to them. Man, they love their Sundays now because they got hope in Baker Mayfield. And I was just impressed the number of throws that he made, the type of leadership being around him a couple days. Man, he is a football playing guy. He is a version of Russell Wilson, Brett Favre, and ultimately trying to be like Drew Brees. Very impressed with what they have going on. Someone asked me the question, if I could have one franchise right now, be in Green Bay and be the head coach there, or the Cleveland Browns be the head coach there, I'm going to Cleveland.
Wow. Really?
Miles Garrett, that defensive end, Ward, the cornerback, Chubb, the running back, Baker Mayfield as the quarterback. You know, man, I like the way they're situated. Pittsburgh, Baltimore, be very, very careful because the Cleveland Browns, they got a serious football team they're going to put on the field the next few years.
Let me address the Panthers first, and then I'll get to Baker. Listen, this is I can nitpick the play calling just like I can nitpick when they went for two against the Lions, not letting Cam get out and move. But in that situation, he had an open receiver. He missed him. I can nitpick on third and fourth and goal, not letting Cam get out and move, not maybe running him or McCaffrey. But he had an open receiver and he missed him. Last week, he had plenty of open receivers, threw four picks. This is a collapse. This is a full-on collapse. I hope it does not cost Ron Rivera's job because I think Ron Rivera is an excellent coach. But going from 6-2 to 6-7 with two games left against the Saints, that's the type of thing.
Yeah, and a new owner.
And a new owner, a great point. And that can cost people their jobs. The Panthers are, they're not eliminated from the playoff picture because that sixth seed's still up for grabs in the NFC. But this is a disastrous, this last 5 weeks of football. That Steelers game, they still haven't recovered from that mollywhopping they took at the hand of Pittsburgh. Now to the Browns. It's rare that we can make definitive statements about a draft class or about a draft during that first season. I feel like I can definitively say the Browns got the pick right. I know there were four quarterbacks taken after Baker in the first round, tied the record. No, there is no doubt in my mind, barring some catastrophic injury, that the Browns got the right guy. He is so clearly ahead of everyone else. I watched Darnold. Darnold has moments of brilliance and then long stretches of futility. Rosen doesn't even have the moments of brilliance right now. Mm-hmm. Josh Allen's a better runner than he is passer. And Lamar right now has been the second best of the rookies, and he's barely throwing the ball. Baker's got stretches of brilliance and then moments of futility. Mm-hmm. He is spectacular, see.
Yeah. I like Baker Mayfield. I liked him before the draft, but I believe he has the type of image and personality that Cleveland needed. They did get it right based on all those things. He really matches up with the culture and the type of team they're trying to put on the field.
All right, we're moving on to a veteran quarterback, Ben Roethlisberger, who had to attempt some late game heroics after missing most of the second half with a rib injury, less than 3 minutes to play. Big Ben threads the needle to find Juju Smith-Schuster in the end zone, his second touchdown of the day, but the Raiders would respond. Derek Carr finding Derek Carrier in the end zone, puts the Raiders up by three, still life for Pittsburgh, and they connect. And the hook and ladder for 43 yards, getting down into field goal range. But the ensuing field goal, this wasn't pretty. Chris Boswell slips. The kick is blocked. Steelers lose 24-21, their third loss in a row. And here's Big Ben after the game.
We all need to look in the mirror and, figure out what's going on. And it starts with each individual needs to look inside first.
What do you think the problem is?
I have no idea. If I knew, we'd have it fixed.
So, see, can the Steelers rebound after their third straight loss?
Yeah, they still can. They're still in the lead in their division. Super Bowl aspirations are with the Pittsburgh Steelers. They're one of the few teams every year. That's one of their goals. It's a realistic goal. Other people say it, like to put it on a T-shirt, but they're one of the franchises, them, New England, and just a couple more that can actually have, these are realistic. They do it from the ownership into the front office and into the players. So they're consistent with, of course they can. Ben, he's got to be able to get better. All those, especially, I like the fact that he said, we all have to take a real conscious look at ourselves in the mirror, and it starts with Ben. Typically, he doesn't do that. He typically excludes himself from that. When you're in a tailspin like this, you're trying to put together good series, good quarters, a good half, and they just haven't been able to do it. I know they have good leadership in Mike Tomlin, but man, you don't go to Oakland late in the season and lose these types of games. So I thought they've been a little fragmented as far as the locker room and some of the thing, their messaging points. I know the L. Bell thing, we haven't talked about it, but that's taxing on a football team because now the backup, who is the starter, now he's out with potentially a high ankle sprain. Don't think he's going to be back for the next two or three games. So their overall talent level this year, they're not as talented. So now you can't overcome things like that, a poor performance in Oakland. They're a less talented football team than they've been the last 4 years.
And this is the second week in a row that they can't take advantage of a golden opportunity, particularly with the New England loss. They host New England next week. You are 2 weeks ago, they're on the road in a very winnable game against Denver. Big Ben throws those red zone picks. Last week, they're at home with a 16-point halftime lead, and they blow it. The first lead of that margin blown at home in Steelers franchise history. And this week, you lose to Oakland. And by the way, this was looking like it was going to be a very typical Steelers game against an inferior opponent on the road. Closer than it should have been.
Right.
Big Ben had some heroics late. And then you let Oakland down four. Not down three, we're a field. Down four. We're only a touchdown can beat you. Drive the length of the field. And you loot like the Boswell, but they just gave Boswell a $17 million contract this offseason as a kicker, which was questionable at the time. He might not see the end of the first year of that contract. He missed two kicks in this game, slipped in the bad turf in Oakland on the end. But you can't leave it up to your kicker. You're playing the Raiders. You're a double. This is Football Outsiders had this stat. It's remarkable. In the last decade, there have only been 11 losses by road favorites of double digits. Teams that go on the road as double-digit favorites. League-wide, in the last decade, there's only been 11 losses. Pittsburgh got four of them.
Wow.
So, like, this is as good as I believe the Mike Tomlin era has been. And prior to the 3 weeks ago, they'd only lost once in their previous 16 road games. Now they've lost both of their last two road games in demoralizing fashion.
And for those who are going to question Mike Tomlin, let me tell you, as a former NFL player, being in a lot of locker rooms, you know what? A coach, a good coach, gets you ready for the big games. The games against people you're better than, you got to get yourself ready for those games. You can't expect a coach to come fire you up when I'm better than. What's coach going to tell you? Oh, you're better than him. Well, okay, you're supposed to play better than him. In those games, the coaching is not as important. And the people don't even think about it that way. You got inferior competition. I'm better than you. The Pittsburgh Steelers and their players typically have just not fared well in those situations. And I don't believe it's the coach's fault. Because you can see in the games that are highly contested, in those games that are most competitive, in those games that mean the most, you know, you don't be a good coach in those situations and then go backwards in those situations. It's the players. The players drop the ball when they look at and the competition and it seems to be inferior.
And they missed Le'Veon Bell and they missed James Conner yesterday as their backup to Le'Veon Bell. The Steelers this year are 6-0-1 when they have at least 75 yards rushing.
Mm-hmm.
They're 1-5 when they don't. Yesterday, 19 for 40. And so that Big Ben missed extended stretch, as you mentioned, to start the second half. Their offense totally went to sleep there. Josh Dobbs, who had played well as a backup before, played really poorly. And this is an inexcusable loss. I don't know that they're going to be okay. I know that the next 2 weeks they have New England and New Orleans, and I know you got a bunch of teams at 7-6 chasing them, forget just for the division, to make the playoffs. The Steelers could go from 7-2-1 to out of the playoffs after three games that they had full control of that they blew each one of them.
All right, let's get to some elite level play. Coming up, did Patrick Mahomes have his MVP moment yesterday? That's next on First Things First.